Krishna Gopeshvara, this is the book that we are going to talk about. And right on the first page, I did a variation of the last shloka of the Bhagavad Gita, and I'm going to recite it now. Yatra Gopeshvara Krishna, Yatra Radha Yogini, Tatra Muktir Anandam, Dhruva Pritir Matir Mama. I have constructed this talk in a different fashion because this book has been around for some time, in the sense that its cover launch was done as far back as November, and it has been in the pre-orders in the works for nearly 2 months. So there have been a lot of questions asked, and a lot of feedback has come on the basis of whatever was available in the public. Things were available in the introduction, in the pre-order. Things were available in the Wikipedia page that was already there on this book and has been there for nearly 3-4 months. So I've constructed this talk in an FAQ fashion. The frequently asked questions. So I have chosen 6 questions that have been most frequently asked, the deeper questions. Of course, there are smaller questions like why is the swastika inverted and all that. And at the end of it, if there is anything more left, then we can always engage. So the first question that was asked was, most frequently asked, why this book? In the sense that there is no shortage of books on Krishna and Krishna's life and the lore around Krishna. So why does somebody have to get up and start writing another book? So the answer to that I have mostly given is that this book gives you a different perspective. I'll just digress a little bit, and I'll refer to an interview that was done with Sheldon Pollack, and it appeared in print yesterday. I would have missed it, but surprise of surprises, it was recommended by Conrad Elst himself. All of us know that both of them do not agree with each other, but this is the merit of great scholars, that if they see something great in another person, they refer it. So, when reading Sheldon Pollack's interview, there's a few things that he said that were very, very, very important. At one plane, Pollack appreciated the spirit of inquiry, openness, imagination, respect for diversity, culture of debate, decency and freedom. On the other plane, he was all praise for the Indian flair for analysis and grammatized thinking. In fact, he went on to say that there is a reason why the Indians are the people who do the best coding. Even if they have to come to US or wherever they do, it is outsourced in India. Why is it that the Indians are the best people to do the coding? And he referred to it on the tradition of grammar that was embedded into the Indian psyche over 2,500 years, as he says. Of course, all of us like to differ from Sheldon Pollack on the timings that he gives to the Indian dates. But this is what makes this book. This is what launches this book. Because this freedom that we have to reimagine our traditions, to reimagine our heroes. Some may like to call them gods. I have referred to all our avatars as human beings, gifted human beings. In fact, there is a lot of opposition to the book on that count. How dare you reimagine Krishna as a human being? But it was important to posit this wonderful tale of human endeavor, of an organic society which had all its organs functioning in tandem, and present it in a manner that can be absorbed by today's millennial as well. I think most of the people sitting here are past that stage, but even the millennial needs to be told that tale, and he has to be told that tale in a manner that he can relate with. The entire Indian tradition is written in a different manner, and the main reason is that it is thousands of years old, and thousands of years old, when the stories were told, there were no paper. They had to memorize it and carry it forward. Now, the best way to memorize anything is that you either present it visually, give it a lot of input of story, imagination, or you put it as aphorisms, because aphorisms are very easy to remember. That is why all our traditions are either as epics with some fantastic tale woven around it, whether it was reality or not, we can debate, but certainly if you weave a lot of imagination around a story, it is easier to remember. Now, in an era when we can record everything, I thought it was important that we try and look at it from a perspective, from a rational perspective, which can rid it of the hyperbole, rid it of the implausible and the impossible, and yet retain the flavor of the original story. Because the epics are not born out of thin air. History, when it is written, though of course the modern way of writing history, especially the way the Marxist writes history or the postmodernist write history, is very different. But when we studied history and the sources of history, one of the most important sources that our old historians have told us, that one of the most important sources of history is culture. What does the culture say about a story? That is also a source of history. And the Marxist style of writing, of course, they have a purpose, they have a vision for themselves, so it is very easy for them to deny it. Unfortunately, even after independence of the last 70 years, most of the time, that is the narrative that has prevailed. But the way I am going to present it in this book, even the Marxists are going to find it very difficult to challenge. So that is one of the reasons why this book came about. And the other reason was that I wanted to give the correct perspective to two of the shlokas which has got distorted in our conversations. The one is Ahimsa Paramo Dharma, and the other is Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. These are, of course, very old sayings, very old teachings, but the context in which they were taught is not quite the context in which it is taken today. When you talk of ahimsa, it does not mean extreme non-violence. It never did in our tradition. Ahimsa only meant that even if you inflict punishment on somebody, there is no violence in your mind. If there is violence in your mind, that is hinsa. If there is no violence in your mind, that is ahimsa. The physical action does not matter. And that was the difference that was taught between kriya and karma. To illustrate it in a very simple manner is that a lot of people go to temples, and the temple somebody goes and overtly he has gone there to pray, and he's just praying to Hanumanji, and from the corner of an eye he sees somebody he doesn't like, and then he prays to Hanumanji, Hanumanji, iska to satyanash kar dena. So the kriya is that you are praying, that is the kriya. But your karma is totally opposed to your kriya, because you have gone there ostensibly to seek peace for yourself. And I always say that ultimately in the Indian tradition, the goal is liberation. And you have the freedom to create your own gods, you have the freedom to create whoever you want, you can go and pray to whoever you want to. But why would anybody in a tradition, in a system where liberation is the ultimate, why would anyone bless you with more bondage? God, give me some wealth. God, make me chief minister. You know, a lot of people are doing a lot of yagnas and such things and asking for chief ministership for themselves, for their sons. I have never understood why a God, if there is one, would bless somebody with more bondage. Aapke bandhanon ko koi bhi bhagwan kyun badhayega? Isliye the difference between kriya and karma comes out very starkly. The kriya of yagna gets tainted by the karma, the intention, the motivation that you have in your mind. And that is what is reflected in the life of Krishna in the fullest measure. So that was something that the difference between kriya and karma I wanted to bring out very clearly through the life of Krishna. That was one of the motivation. The other was the Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam part. Now the Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam has become some kind of a slogan for everyone. One guy reminds other, look, you're not following Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. The other one says, no, no, we are Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. What does Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam mean after all? Does it mean that anybody who is walking on the street and he begs you that I want to come to your house and you bring him in and say that this is Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam? I'll just explain to you the origin of Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam is in a purely spiritual context. The first time Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam occurs is in Mahopanishad. And the context is purely spiritual. And later on, when some foolish kings wanted to employ this to mean that, okay, we are decent to everyone, even if somebody says something bad to us, we will be decent to him and we will accommodate him and we will not resist his evil narrative even if he is trying to propagate something. There's a beautiful story in Hitopadesh. That Hitopadesh story, I'll just briefly recount here because it is very, very pertinent to this book. The Hitopadesh story goes like this. There used to be a deer. The name of the deer was Chitrang. And there was a jackal who came around and he saw the deer, and his absolutely craving for the meat of the deer. But he knew that there is no way that he can chase the deer down. Therefore, he has to adopt some other rules. So what he does is that he goes to the deer and he tells him, look, I have come from outside and I am new to this place, and would you please give me shelter in your house? So the deer is very suspicious. Of course, he knows that there are jackals, and jackals are not always good, especially for the deers. So he says, no, sorry. I do not admit strangers into my house. So at this point, the jackal utters this shloka, recites the shloka. Ayo nijam paro veti garnam laghu cheta sam udara charita nam tu vasudhaiva kutambukam. Now this deer gets mighty impressed. You know, even today, if somebody recites a shloka, then an ordinary person gets impressed. So even in those times, I thought it was something like that. A lot of people are making taking advantage of this situation, reciting shlokas and misleading people. So the deer was very impressed. Yeah, this guy looks very, very knowledgeable. This guy is good. So, okay. So he says, okay, come on. Now, this deer, Chitrang, and this jackal, his name in the Hitopadesh story is Shudrabuddhi. And this deer had a crow as a friend. The name of the crow was Subuddhi. So when Subuddhi saw them coming, and he found that this guy was going to give shelter to a jackal, then he told him, what the hell are you doing? Have you gone mad? You do not give shelter to anyone without finding out his antecedents, his past. Okay, no. You are very suspicious of me, but this guy is very good. He knows shlokas. He recites beautiful shlokas. So he cannot be bad. So I will take him in anyway. So then he recounts another tale, this Subuddhi, and shows him how there was an old vulture, and there was a cat, and the birds entrusted him with their birdlings. Then this cat came and somehow managed to prevail over that vulture. Okay, look, I will help you in this job. His eyes were almost gone. And making use of that trust, taking advantage of that trust, he started picking off the little birds one by one. And ultimately, when the parent birds came to know of this, they killed that vulture. But even that did not have any effect on Chitrang. He's like, no, I have decided this. This is a very, very wise person, very, very wise jackal, and I must have him in my house. And the story kind of meanders, and in the end what happens is that jackal, when he finds his opportunity, he lures the deer into a trap in a farmer's place. And then there's a beautiful conversation. He says that the deer tells him, he saw him coming, so he was very happy. He said, look, my friend has come now. He has very sharp teeth, and I got trapped in this net, and he'll take me out. So he tells him, now that you have come, you please, you take me out. You can bite this off very easily. You have got very sharp teeth. So Jackal says, okay, look, I can, but the problem is today is Sunday and today is my fast. So I cannot bite off this leather today. You wait, tomorrow I'll do it. He was just waiting. He let this guy get fatigued and then I eat him up. And then Subuddhi comes and uses his intelligence and rescues him. Now, this is exactly the message of Krishna all through his life. Don't let the bad people, the evil people, defeat you through deception. Learn to look through deception and elevate your consciousness to a level where you do not have to struggle with this little dilemma about whether to resist the evil or not, how to recognize it and how to destroy it. The second question that is very frequently asked is that this book is constructed as a tale of clashing narratives. What are these clashing narratives? This clash of narratives has been a constant theme in the Indian tradition. It begins in Rig Veda and goes through the epics and the Puranas. Everywhere you have a harmonizing narrative and you have a divisive narrative. And the clash has been going on throughout the prehistory. Every now and then, when the harmonizing narrative or what is called the dharmic narrative is in trouble, then somebody gifted like Krishna comes and rescues it. These are men who have a higher level of consciousness than most of us, and they work to the benefit of humanity. That is why in our lore they've been called avataras. And the other narrative was not coming through, so I used a fiction and I created a character called Kutil Muni, and he propagates a dharma called Kutil Dharma, which is full of deception and deviousness and concentration of power for self-aggrandizement. That is why it is called Kutil Dharma, and the narrative, the clash of narrative is between the dharmic narrative and the Kutil narrative, and that's how it goes in the, as far as the second question is concerned. The third question that has been very often asked, and in fact sometimes very agitatedly, very very agitatedly, that why do you portray Krishna as a human being? And some of it I've already answered. There was there was a pre-order launch function where I was asked this question. Sir, do you treat Krishna as a god or as a human being? If so, why? So I just recited the second shloka of Ishopanishad, and I said that as far as Ishwar is concerned, for me it means Isha Vasamidam Sarvam Yat Kinchit Jagatyam Jagat. Therefore, Krishna is Ishwar, I am Ishwar, you are Ishwar, everyone sitting here is Ishwar, and all of them are interacting as Ishwar, so don't worry about it. Then a third aspect which is very important is that Krishna is also a very, very important teacher. Very often a comparison is made between Rama and Krishna. And Rama is neither accorded the title of Yogeshwar, nor is he given the title of Jagatguru. These titles are available among the Dashavataras only to Krishna. And there's a reason for that. The reason for that and the significant reason for that is that I have absolutely no doubt that Rama also had all these capabilities, but he bound himself up in maryada. He tried to project his own character as the standard to which people could easily adhere. And because of that maryada of character or charitrik maryada, that he needed to project to his people, he was bonded up. He became a king, so he got bound by Rajadharma. When you are bound by Rajdharma and you have this bondage, then you cannot really be free and liberated. Whereas when this choice came to Krishna, he did not bind himself in Rajdharma. He actually, even after conquering Kansa, even after establishing Dwarka, he chose to give up that chain of kingship. He was never a king. He is Dwarkadhish, but he is not the king of Dwarka. I think we are all sitting here in Gujarat, we know that he is Dwarkadhish, but he was never the king of Dwarka. That is a very, very rare phenomenon in any story or in any history. Then the fourth question that I've often been asked is that you say that this is an explanation of Krishna's life and events around Krishna's life from a rational perspective. So what do you mean by the rational perspective? Some of it I've already explained. But just to sum up and reiterate, the rational perspective simply means that the book does not treat Krishna as a miracle maker endowed with superhuman powers. He is a gifted, precocious child in this book. And I think in our experiences, all of us would have come across such children who are far advanced beyond their age, in their intellect, in their capacities, even in their physical capacities. And they can do things that we would not ordinarily imagine. We have seen people like Shakuntala Devi, for instance. Even as a small child, she could do things that nobody would think possible, or somebody like Ramanuja. Nobody even knows where he got that gift of mathematics from. Even in our neighborhoods, we would have seen somebody like Sachin Tendulkar. It was clear, his talent was clear from the age of 10. Everybody could see that this guy is going to go places. I'm giving this cricket example because I am into cricket a little bit and I've seen this. This boy, this Rishabh Pant, who is such a hit today in IPL, we groomed him as an 11-year-old in our own district team, Barmer. He's played 5 years for Barmer. So, my Krishna in Krishna Gopeshwar is a gifted, genius, precocious child, very much a human being and very much doing things which are possible for a human being to do. That is why some of the events which are glorified in certain manner and treated as miracles in the Krishna lore, I simply simplified it. Just to give you an example of the Govardhan Hill, how the Govardhan Mountain was lifted up by Krishna on his little finger. So if you take it literally, it's just not possible. Can anyone? I think never has anybody seen anybody lifting up a mountain. Forget mountain, you can't even lift up this book on this little finger. So definitely, how this would have happened or could have happened, I've shown this in the book. So what happens is that there is a great flood. This boy is a very, very inquisitive boy. They had just shifted from Gokul to Vrindavan. And after going to Vrindavan, he observed certain natural phenomena. And with his herd, he would go to the mountain. Now that mountain, I'm told, is much smaller than what it used to be in those times. In fact, there is a tradition there in Govardhan which says that this mountain drops about 1.5 feet every year. Anyway, but then if you go around a mountain and search around it, then definitely you are able to find places where to shelter your people and shelter your cattle in case of a calamity. So that is how I imagine that this would have happened. If a flood came, a storm hit the place, if you see the distance between Vrindavan and Govardhan, it's about 15, 16 kilometers. And it's all uphill. So naturally, if a storm is hitting and your village is about to get flooded, you would move uphill. You would go to the higher ground. And therefore, he would have gone, and with his knowledge of the area that he would travel every day, and with his not superhuman abilities, but his super brain that he had, he took all his people there, sheltered them, had a carnival for 10 days, and after the storm went away, he came down. And the story traveled. The story traveled in a very different manner. When the story travels, it gathers moss, it gathers dross. Both of the things that it gathers. And when that story traveled to Mathura, say in about 15 days of time, the communication lines were not such. We had no mobiles at that time. Not even telephones, nothing. So for a story to travel from Vrindavan to Mathura, which is a distance today only of about 12 kilometers, it would certainly have taken at least 15 days in those times. So that whole area was forested. And when such tales travel, when Kamsa is expecting that, okay, we had this great fortune or this great flood, even Mathura was flooded, we had great difficulty, so many people died here, so Vrindavan would have been washed away. And then somebody comes and says, no, nothing happened. These guys were frolicking around. And then he comes and adds a few things, a little eye here, a little, cuts a little T there, puts a double dots on an eye here. And suddenly a tail develops. So today, when we are sitting here, and when we are talking to an audience, which, rightly or wrongly, relies more on intellect, then all these tales must be intellectualized. And because they need to be intellectualized, that is why people like us have a duty cast on us to make it appear in a manner which can be plausible, possible, and therefore acceptable. I just give you a few examples to buttress this point. We have the examples in the Vedas to fire. Now, when you take it literally, it just means a physical fire that burns. But the reference to fire is in a myriad different ways. And the highest reference to fire in Vedas is what is called Chidagni. Chidagni is that fire of consciousness which dwells in every being, not just every human being, in every being, which is also mentioned again in Gita in a different manner, in which I think in the 13th adhyay, Krishna is saying, Samam sarveshu bhuteshu tishthanti parameshwaram vinashyatsu avinashyantam yah pashyati sapashyati. So if you take fire in that way, the meaning is totally different. And it has happened not only in our tradition, it has happened in various other traditions as well. For instance, we see the difficulties that the world is facing because Islam went into literalism from a very, very open kind of interpretation once upon a time. The Christianity suffered for 1,000 years. The dark ages of Christianity are exactly those times when literalism prevailed. We had this recent controversy about Sita being made to enter fire, and then people throw all kind of ridicule on that. How can a person go into fire and come out alive? If you look at it literally, of course it will sound absurd. There is no doubt that it is going to sound absurd. But if you look at the context and you look at the different meanings of Agni, I think Agni has about 100 meanings in Sanskrit. And when you look at the context and you take it back when Sita has admonished Lakshman, when he refused to go in aid of Ram, when she heard him shout, Mardala, Mardala, or whatever was the Sanskrit equivalent at that time. So Sita tells Lakshman, you have bad intention in your heart. You are coveting me. That is why you want your brother to die. That is why you are not going. These were the harsh words that actually forced Lakshman to give up his dharma and go to the rescue of his brother when he knew full well that this was not the case. And that led to that entire episode. So the agni that Sita is made to enter by Rama is the agni of prayaschit. And there are a million references to prayaschit agni in our tradition. When somebody is not acquainted with it and goes into it literally, then he'll come out with these absurdities. That is why there is a need to intellectualize and rationalize and explain the what we see as things that are not humanly possible. They need to be explained. They don't need to be laughed at. Then the sixth question which has often been asked is, what is this damned kutil dharma? Now, of course, I have taken liberties because I have written this as a fiction. So kutil dharma is just a metaphor for a totalitarian cult that combines political and religious power, that aspires to combine political and religious power, which is what Kansa was aiming at, but he wasn't able to do because he had the great handicap of having both his wives as daughters of Jarasandha, who was the greatest Shiva Bhakt of that time. Of course, his Shiva Bhakti was also purely false. Self-aggrandizement, and not for any altruistic purpose. But he was always trying to break free. He was always oppressing his people. He was even breaking temples. He was indulging in unspeakable horrors against his people. Therefore, it is very convenient fiction where we create a teacher which goes to Kansa, drills something into him, and we are able to weave a tale around it. I was also asked whether you are trying to give a hidden message through this book. Somebody said that this book is expressly against monotheism. I had a counter question. I said, look, Ekeshwarvad, as we know in this land, is as old as history itself. Though, of course, our Ekeshwarvad is more geared towards one energy, one supreme, as I said, Samam Sarveshu Bhuteshu, of that kind. Within our tradition, there have been attempts where people have wanted to arrogate the one supreme to themselves and try and become supreme power on this earth. There is the example of Hiranyakashipu. We know that entire story. We also know the story of Bali. He wanted to become the one supreme. And the story, at least in the Indian land, the land that lies north of Samudra and south of the Himalayas, is that whenever such an attempt has been made, it has been thwarted. And the principle of one energy, one supreme, has been reverberating in this land ever since history began, from prehistory. And it is only now that science is zeroing on to it. I also allude to this sense of science, because after the attempts began, when relativity made nonsense of Newton's laws, and quantum mechanics made further nonsense of Newton's laws, ever since then, there has been an attempt to converge the two. The relativity, which is science of the very large, quantum mechanics, which is a science of the very small. Then in the quantum mechanics, we also have the uncertainty principle, which we see all the time in our daily experience. And this attempt has been going on for the last 40, 50 years. The attempt to merge the two and make into it what is called quantum gravity has not been successful. And that is why now the physicists, the most advanced physicists, are feeling that probably we've reached the limits of observable physics or the empirical physics. And the counterintuitive physics has to give way to the intuitive physics. May they succeed, because hints are always there. We don't have an empirical proof yet. But some people must have felt it within them. It is not for nothing that for thousands of years, people have been talking of this one energy. And I end this talk by wishing success to our scientists, that they be able to locate and prove that one energy, which Gita has said, resides in all of us. And I recite the shloka, the last shloka of Bhagavad Gita, which will also be the beginning of my next part of this series. This is the first part, Krishna Gopeshvara. The next one is going to be Krishna Yogeshwar, and the last one will be Krishna Gyaneshwar. Yatra Yogeshwarah Krishno, Yatra Partho Dhanurdharah, Tatra Shri Vijayor Bhutir Dhruva Nitir Matir Mama. Namaskar.
This is a trilogy. This being a trilogy, I have had to divide the entire life story of Krishna into three parts. And Yogeshwar is the form which is best associated with Gita and the actual Mahabharata war. As I said right in the end of my narration, Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna is the last shloka of Gita. So when it came to Yogeshwara, I thought that it would best fit that part where Gita is getting described, which is the next part. So the next part is going to be Krishna Yogeshwara. And this is the part where Krishna is actually a gop. So Gopeshwara. And there would be a final part where Krishna, when he finally leaves this physical world and he imparts his final gyan to Uddhava, that is called Krishna Gyaneshwar. In fact, I have crafted a little shloka even for that. Yatra Gyaneshwara Krishno, Yatra Uddhava Jitendriya, Tatra Pragya Kaivalyam, Dhruva Sthitir Matir Mama. That's what it is. I think as far as whether Muni can be Kutil or not, I think you have got plenty of empirical evidence right today. So that's actually a no-brainer. So just by keeping the name Muni, that guy is not going to be Kutil, there's absolutely no guarantee. So that's as far as a Muni not being Kutil is concerned. Just naming oneself as Muni, the Kutilta doesn't go away. Kutil Dharma is actually, it's a name given to a totalitarian cult. In the book, it is a violent cult which seeks to impose itself on others through violence. People have tried to draw comparison with monotheistic cults, but monotheistic cults are not all violent. You see, within India, you have the Jewish population. The Jewish, they are monotheistics. In fact, they are the oldest monotheistic cult or religion, you may call it. So they are the oldest monotheistic religion, but they are not violent because they do not seek to proselytize. They do not have this expansionist urge. Similarly, even Zoroastrianism is a monotheistic religion, but even they do not force themselves upon others. Even within some of the proselytizing religions, there are elements which nobody would object to. For instance, even within Islam, why would anybody object to Tawheed? There's absolutely no problem. You can have your Tawheed. Even in this tradition, this land, there will be a number of these philosophies and a number of these thoughts that have prevailed without anybody having any trouble over them. The problem arises when you force yourself upon others. There's a line in this. I'll just recount that line. It's there in the book. That the essential of Kutil Dharma is that it denies paths of existence to all other religions. I think the narratives are very clearly defined. Okay. In the book, when you read the book, you will find that the narratives are very, very clearly defined. There is absolutely no ambiguity about it. And even the nuances have been worked out. Like the previous question, it was asked, and I made it clear that the problem occurs when a narrative is accompanied by violence. That is where the problem occurs. Otherwise, you can have multifarious narratives. In fact, when we said ekam sadvipra baudha odanti, that was that all paths lead to the same supreme. In the book, we made it very clear who are the vipras. Those people who try and force themselves over others, they cannot be treated as vipras. They are monsters. They are the Kutil Dharmis. This second part of the shloka, as it is narrated often, actually doesn't have any evidence. However, it has been narrated by Swami Chinmayanand, who is himself an authority on this, that he adds that dharma hinsa tathayavcha. This is dealt with in some detail in the book. I'll just give you an example. There's this question of when we are looking at how Kans is slowly losing his sanity. And in the book, it is described finally that Kans already stands defeated in mind before the final denouement comes, before that final battle with Kans in the wrestling arena. Kansa's people have deserted. his army has deserted. His Magadha warriors are busy only protecting the Magadha queens or the Magadha princesses. He is already defeated in mind completely. And it gets reflected when the event happens. And finally, he loses his mind. He is flailing about. He is completely lost. And it is in that kind of a state of stupor that Kamsa catches him. Then Balaram tells him, hey, look, this man is gone. Why kill him? So basically, Balaram is telling him Ahimsa Paramo Dharma. Yes. Now, I'll not reveal it further. You read the counter to that. Yes. It's given in fair detail. It even, in this Krishna, even invokes the public and asks the public, what do you tell me to do? This is what I think. Public goes with him.